November 1980. Three Sea Harriers embark on HMS Invincible. The end of a chapter and the long story of Britain's unique vertical takeoff jet. 17 years earlier, the Hawker P1127, the prototype of the Harrier concept, successfully landed vertically aboard HMS Ark Royal. But the Royal Navy was not, at that time, interested in a subsonic aircraft, however revolutionary. To supplement the existing fleet carriers, like the Ark Royal, the Navy had a new supercarrier, CVA-01, in prospect, and the new generation of supersonic jet fighters on order. Supersonic interceptors was also the RAF's main requirement in the 60s, as a replacement for its aging Lightnings. The aircraft, which was to be all things to all airmen, was TSR-2, a multi-role supersonic aircraft which was at that time showing great promise. But TSR-2, aside from its mounting development costs, had, like all military jets, an Achilles heel. It required tens of thousands of yards of concrete runway to take off and land, and runways in a missile age are vulnerable. Indeed, even the short grass airfields used by Spitfires and Hurricanes during the Battle of Britain were to be made unusable when, towards the end of that conflict, the Luftwaffe began systematically to bomb them. Had the Germans done so from the outset, the Battle of Britain could well have ended in defeat for the RAF. Later in the war, Allied daylight bombers attacked German airfields. Post-war, the vulnerability of airfields was to lead to the concept of vertical takeoff short landing aircraft, VSTOL. One of the first was proposed by a German, Schmidt, who in 1930 patented a pulse jet and arranged three of these simple engines to lift a light aircraft vertically. The aircraft was not built, but the pulse jets were. To power the short takeoff, vertical landing, V1 flying bomb. In 1953, Rolls-Royce built their Jet Control Research Unit, popularly known as the Flying Bedstead, which dramatically demonstrated that vertical jet-powered flight could be achieved without wings, stable control being effected by small air jets on outriggers. Profiting from that experiment, a Rolls-Royce Avon jet powered the rather more elegant American Ryan X-13, which was controlled using wingtip air jets bled from the engine's compressor. Though purely a research project, the X-13 successfully achieved 125 transitions from vertical to wing-borne flight. Landing, however, was conventional. Following the X-13, the Bell X-14 was powered by two Armstrong Siddeley Viper jets, which could vector downwards for takeoff and landing, and rearwards for level flight. The British Short SC-1, on the other hand, represented a different solution to the problem. Four Rolls-Royce RB-108 lift engines with a fifth engine for conventional flight. This multi-engine concept was vigorously championed by Rolls-Royce, though there were dissenters, among whom was Sir Stanley Hooker.
We here at Bristol, particularly me if you like, took no interest in that solution for a variety of reasons. Number one is because to make an effective service aeroplane, we studied it deeply. We came to the conclusion you needed at least eight engines. There's two spare ones, really. And if you have eight engines in a single-seater fighter, then the pilot obviously can't monitor eight engines for takeoff. And it's takeoff and he likes to think he's in control of the aeroplane. And so he really meant he'd got to press a button. And in those days, I used to rather facetiously say, well, he presses the button, shuts his eyes, and if he's alive, 1 minute later, he's flying.
In the 50s, there was a group of Americans in Paris running the Mutual Weapons Development Program to fund promising NATO projects. One proposal was Michel Vibault's gyrocopter, which basically consisted of a Bristol Orion turbojet driving four blowers which could be rotated downwards for vertical flight.
I thought the whole idea was a bit crazy at the time anyhow, let's be quite frank about it, but I said if we've got to be interested in this thing, we wouldn't do it that way, you see.
Hooker decided to modify an existing Orpheus engine by adding a single large compressor fan.
The front fan is the equivalent of Vibo's centrifugal blowers, except that his blowers were on the side and there were four of them here. But this one is right in the front and the surplus air is taken off into the nozzles and the nozzles can be directed downwards to lift or rearwards to push. So that was the equivalent of his four centrifugal blowers, and all the cross shafts and gearboxes had by then disappeared. Then, of course, having built yourself a big fan compressor of that kind, it's only sensible to supercharge the engine, which has got to produce the power by means of it as well. And so that provided the layout of this engine. You have a big fan, which has surplus air. The surplus air you use for lift out of the side. The other air goes in and supercharges the main core of the engine to produce more power. And then, of course, one splits the jet similarly and rotates it. It seemed to be about the right size, and after all, the thing was then going to give, it originally started off, I think, 13,500 pounds of lift, which was a reasonable size aeroplane. That seemed a reasonable start for the thing anyhow. And so the whole thing fitted together with already a component that the Americans had paid for.
That being the Bristol Orpheus, which was to form the major component of the new engine to be named Pegasus. But to power what? It was 1957, and the worst possible moment, following the famous Duncan Sands statement on defence, that the days of the manned fighter were numbered. Planes like these Hunters, built by the Hawker Company, who had supplied military aircraft to the RAF since the 1920s. In 1931, Hawker Furies were the first RAF fighters to exceed 200 miles per hour. They were elegant biplanes which epitomised a vanished era, and came, like all subsequent Hawker aircraft, from the drawing board of the company's chief designer, Sir Sidney Cam, a man who was never reluctant to adapt to change, as in 1936.
It means leaving the biplane, which we know so well, and going to the monoplane with heavier armament and many new features such as closed cockpit, retractable undercarriage, higher wing loading, and of course, new structural problems.
The new monoplane Sir Sidney had designed was the Hurricane, which, though overshadowed by the Spitfire, outnumbered its more glamorous contemporary during the Battle of Britain. The Kingston Design Office and Factory, which had produced the Hurricane and the Hunter, was in 1958 a depressed area. The Hunter's replacement, the supersonic P-1121, was, when 85% complete, cancelled in the wake of the Sands paper, which saw guided missiles as the future front line of air defence. Having lost the 1121, Hawkers explored other, less frequented byways. Following which, Sir Sidney Cam wrote a letter.
Very short letter, which I've lost, unfortunately, which he said, "Dear Hooker, what are you doing about vertical takeoff? Yours, S. Cam." And so I sent him a brochure of this. And I didn't hear and forgot about it, because we were in the throes of TSR-2 at the time, and they're very heavily engaged on TSR-2 and other things, and this didn't get a lot of one's attention. And so a month or two later, a very irate Cam came on the telephone and said, "When the hell are you coming to see me?" And I said, "Well, come and see you any time, Sir Sidney. You know, what's the subject?" And he said, "We've got an aeroplane designed around your engine." I said, "Which engine?" He said, "This lifting engine of yours, of course, you BF, you know." And so up I went, and there it was on a drawing board. And it looked exactly like that.
The first P-1127 to fly was a 1/6 model tested by NASA at Langley Field. Though tethered, the model was self-powered and could perform vertical takeoffs, transitions to level flight, and vertical landings. However, ominously, it was found it required no fewer than 4 pilots simultaneously to control the model aircraft. Shortly after the NASA tests, in October 1960, the prototype 1127 was rolled out at Dunsfold Airfield for its maiden flight. It was not an attractive aircraft, and whatever its aeronautical promise, it was a bureaucratic nightmare.
There we had an aeroplane, paid for and funded on UK money, with an engine that was going to fly the aeroplane, which was three-quarters owned by some Americans based in Paris, and the rest of it was owned by Bristol. And the paperwork for that took some sorting out, I can tell you.
The man who was to fly the 1127 was Hawker Siddeley's chief test pilot, Bill Bedford.
I suppose I was impressed by seeing a rather ugly-looking aeroplane situated on a gridded platform, myself with my ankle in plaster, because someone had driven me into a tree in a motor car. I finished up with this extraordinary medical category of fit civil test pilot, tethered, hovering only. And I recall sitting in the aeroplane on this platform. The aircraft was tied down with tethers to give it only about 1 foot of freedom of movement. open the throttle progressively, and with a certain amount of uncertainty, the aircraft erratically got itself just into the air.
The first hover was only 1 minute and 45 seconds, but it proved to the watching Sir Sidney Cam that vertical takeoff was at least feasible. The next step for Bill Bedford was to achieve sustained controlled hover without the restraining ropes. After 21 tethered sorties, Bedford had mastered the technique and hovered the underpowered P-1127 in free flight. By September 1960, he had successfully made the transition from the hover to conventional flight. In the succeeding months, Bill Bedford, assisted now by Hugh Merriweather and other test pilots, flew the first prototype and a second, which had now also been built. And step by step, the VSTOL concept developed. By the end of 1961, the prototype had exceeded Mach 1 in a shallow dive. But there was a serious setback when Bill Bedford had to bail out of the second aircraft when an experimental glass fiber jet nozzle fell off. There were sundry minor fires and engine problems, all part of the constant risk of flying experimental aircraft, which was accepted by the small band of dedicated test pilots. In 1963, with an uprated Pegasus installed, the 1127 was demonstrated to the services with, it must be said, an almost total lack of response. Typical of these depressing sorties was when Bill Bedford took the 1127 out to sea.
Approached the aircraft carrier, Ark Royal, came in to the hover, landed vertically and quite uneventfully on the ship. That was at about noon on that very, which really was quite a historic day. And I clearly recall the comment that was made by the Admiral Flag Officer Aircraft Carrier, Sir Donald Gibson. He said, "The thing that impressed me most about your flight was the complete absence of fright on the part of the spectators." He said, "Normally new aircraft come aboard bigger, heavier and faster, and here is a complete reversal of the trend."
Which was not what the Navy wanted. By then, the 1127 had a serious rival for NATO favours, the French Dassault Balzac. Both it and the 1127 were to be flown at the 1963 Paris Air Show. The Hawker camp felt that their machines had the edge over the opposition because the Balzac, which had separate lift engines, could only take off from a special concrete pad, and Bill Bedford designed his display to upstage the French aircraft in front of the home crowd.
Took off at 13 minutes past five, one aircraft a short takeoff from the runway, one aircraft a short takeoff from the grass. The easiest part of our activity, the one that all pilots thoroughly enjoy, that of the stimulation of demonstration flying in an international arena. Conventional flying over, I did a decelerating transition, did a turn. The intention had been to land vertically on the grass adjacent to the large concrete platform that had been provided for our competitor, the Balzac, because the Balzac couldn't land on the grass without doing a lot of damage. Furthermore, it was unable to lift off vertically, having once landed without the aid of a special water-cooled platform, which it didn't have on the platform. As I was completing my turn to straighten out, suddenly I found the aeroplane plummeting earthwards, completely out of control, and I arrived ignominiously with a major crash on the concrete platform that had been prepared for our competitor. Dust, dirt, wheels, everything flying all over the place. And I recall one or two things. Firstly, that the ground was much closer than it normally was when I got out of the aeroplane because the undercarriage had been amputated.
The thud that went around the world, the French press gleefully reported. The cause of that crash was trivial, simply a speck of dirt jamming a hydraulic valve. Happily, XP-831 was rebuilt and is now in the RAF Museum at Hendon. Despite the Paris crash, the lights for the 1127 were turning, if not to green, at least to amber.
Chiefly due to largely American interest, the governments of America and England and Germany, Western Germany, promised to get together and fund the development of a slightly more advanced version of that 1127, which was subsequently called the Kestrel.
9 Kestrels were ordered and constructed. They differed considerably from the 1127 prototype. The wings and jet nozzles were revised, and low-pressure tyres were fitted to enable the aircraft to operate from grass fields, a feat that no contemporary jet fighter could emulate. In 1964-65, the Kestrels were formed into a NATO tripartite squadron. At the end of the successful trials, 3 of the Kestrels were shipped to the United States for evaluation, but the lights turned once again to red, and no orders were forthcoming. In Britain, the aircraft that was seen to be the one to fulfil RAF requirements to the end of the century was TSR-2, the supersonic tactical strike reconnaissance aircraft, which was then perhaps rightly considered to be a potential world beater, so much so that no one on the air staff considered vertical takeoff as a serious rival for this powerful aircraft. The Royal Navy's Fleet Air Arm now had their Rolls-Royce Spey Engine Phantom. The last thing that the admirals wanted was a V-Stahl aircraft which would make their fleet carriers unnecessary. No one in Whitehall took Sir Sidney Cam's Kestrel seriously.
I remember one Air Force chap describing this as a pedestrian aeroplane, which nearly gave Sidney apoplexy, because any criticism of any Hawker aeroplane gave him apoplexy. He wasn't very good at meetings, you know. He was a rather shy chap, despite everything, and I attended a meeting with him in the ministry, and a large meeting which got out of control, and they were arguing about the electronics or something in the aeroplane, and finally the chairman of the meeting turned to Sir Sidney and said, "Well, what would you do, Sir Sidney?" And he said, "Well, first of all," he said, "I'd shoot that bugger over there."
Cam had designed a supersonic version of the 1127, the 1154. However, the Navy and the RAF had to agree on a common airframe. This they could not do. The Navy dropped out. Then the 1964 Wilson government cancelled the whole project. Even-handedly, they also cancelled that white hope of the British aerospace industry, TSR-2, in favour of RAF Rolls-Royce-engined American McDonnell Phantoms. This pragmatic approach to the defence budget was to concentrate the minds of the air staff wonderfully. At Kingston, a good deal of work had been done on the 1154. But with the cancellation, work on the prototype was stopped. But unlike the TSR-2 project, this was not to prove a total loss.
But unlike some design teams in the UK, we at Kingston, although we were grief-stricken over the cancellation, the aircraft was about a third built when that happened. The engine had run on the test bed. An engine like the Pegasus, but with this Pelham chamber burning, it had run, in fact, at over 30,000 pounds of thrust with the burners working. We were told at Kingston, unlike other teams, as I've mentioned, that whilst that aircraft was cancelled, we were not going to be starved of further work. We were told to redesign the Kestrel, which you remember was then about to be used in the evaluation squadron, fit in the Kestrel, all the operational kit that was being developed for the supersonic 1154, and turn the aircraft into a thoroughly operational subsonic V-Stahl attack fighter. The rules, they've become more familiar since, perhaps this is the first time they arrived, they were applied. Really said, take the Kestrel, change it into a really operational aircraft in 4 years from now, don't spend much money, make it better, make it really capable, for God's sake, don't change many drawings. Well, we changed about 93.5% of the drawings, and I don't regret one drawing change, because with the experience we'd had with the 1127, the Kestrel, and then the thing that became the Harrier, we got a really proven, been through the fire, operational aircraft that went into service exactly on schedule in 1969.
It was a memorable debut as squadron leader Leckie Thompson rose from the dust of the Paddington coal yard at the start of the Daily Mail transatlantic air race, flying the 4th production squadron Harrier, bound for New York. The aircraft was refueled several times en route over the Atlantic from RAF Victor tankers, luckily without incident. For it was later discovered that the Harrier's refueling pipes had a tendency to burst under pressure. And if that had happened during the race, the Harrier would have made an unscheduled vertical landing into the Atlantic Ocean. The Harrier's London-New York time was 5 hours 57 minutes for the 3,030 nautical mile trip, good enough to set up the fastest time of the race and establish several records. The Harrier's arrival in the centre of New York City created a considerable stir. Today, some 60 Harriers are now operational with 4 RAF squadrons, including a number of two-seater T-4 trainers. The single-seater operational RAF Harriers do not normally take off vertically. Rather, in order to extend their range, they use a short rolling takeoff. The principal role of the Harrier squadrons is tactical reconnaissance and close support of NATO ground forces, it being considered that the ability of Harriers to operate independently of fixed bases will enable them to react quickly to any Warsaw Pact threat and to achieve very low level penetration of enemy airspace. Targets can be programmed into an unjammable inertial navigational system with a moving map continuously pinpointing the aircraft's position. A head-up display on the windscreen enables the pilot to concentrate on an ultra-low-level attack. The RAF Harrier's armament is carried on underwing hardpoints up to a weight of 5,000 pounds, in addition to reconnaissance cameras. Some versions of the Harrier are armed with Sidewinder air-to-air missiles. But the unique combat asset of this, the West's only vertical takeoff and landing aircraft in service, is its independence of a permanent airfield base. It's claimed that Harriers, even if caught on the ground on an airfield, could still take off where conventional aircraft could not. What's it like to fly this unique aircraft? Here is part of a training film.
For this particular sortie, the required speed is 90 knots. And the nozzle angle, 60 degrees. The pilot presets this angle by means of a stop. The nozzle lever itself is kept fully forward. All checks complete, full power. At 90 knots, nozzle lever back to the stop. The nozzles rotate and the aircraft lifts off. Now move the nozzle lever slowly forwards, rotating the nozzles to the horizontal position and accelerating the Harrier into wing-borne flight. At the end of a sortie, with weapons gone and fuel load reduced, a vertical landing can always be made. In this instance, the landing area is a bombed runway, and the pilot makes a rolling vertical landing in which the aircraft is kept moving forwards to ensure that all debris is left behind. Prior to a vertical landing, the pilot makes a decelerating transition. The nozzle selector lever is drawn fully back to rotate the nozzles to the reverse thrust position. The airspeed falls away very quickly, and as it does so, the pilot opens the throttle to compensate the decreasing wing lift with increasing jet lift. As the airspeed falls to zero, the pilot inches the nozzle selector lever forward to the hover stop. The throttle has now become the height control. Heading is controlled by the rudder, roll and pitch by small natural movements of the stick, exactly as in conventional flight. To initiate the vertical landing, the pilot reduces the power slightly and controls the rate of descent with the throttle. Before starting a vertical takeoff, the pilot moves the nozzle selector lever to the hover position. He opens the throttle to full power, and the aircraft lifts off. Undercarriage up. Now move the nozzle selector lever gradually forwards, and the Harrier accelerates into wing-borne flight. Flying the Harrier is not difficult. The principles remain the same, whatever the environment.
But the RAF accident record with Harriers appears bad. 24 aircraft out of 110 being lost since 1969, many write-offs being ascribed to pilot error. This incident at least proves the immense strength of the Harrier's undercarriage, confounding Sir Sidney Cam's gloomy prediction that the wingtip outriggers would snap like carrots. This Harrier survived what might be described as a heavy takeoff. Since the early days, the RAF have revised their training and the accident rate has dropped dramatically. But it is fair to ask, is the Harrier accident prone?
Its accident rate has received, in my view, a lot of adverse publicity. Adverse because it's not really accurate. The only way to discuss accident rates is to get the statistics out, to know the number of times an airplane fleet has taken off and landed, the number of miles it's flown, the hours it's flown, the number of pilots who've been converted to it and so on, and then to look at the numbers of accidents. Now this is a very technical and an accountant-like operation. If that is done with a Harrier, you will find that it comes out extremely high in the batting average. Very low accident rates compared with other modern military airplanes. But some of the other modern military airplanes have not attracted the publicity of your jump jet.
John Farley, Bill Bedford's successor, has in the course of demonstration flying achieved remarkable takeoffs. An even more spectacular takeoff was in the Swiss Alps.
And one of the characteristics that we wished to demonstrate in Switzerland was that you could base this aircraft in the bottom of valleys and so on, in places where ordinary aircraft could not sensibly take off and land. So yes, we were caught once or twice taking off and climbing up mountain faces and so on to demonstrate this extra capability that is present in this sort of aircraft.
Of course, John's being very, very modest, really. I mean, it was a most spectacular display to see this aircraft going up the side of a mountain in Switzerland, and the locals called the mountain after him Monte Farley, which I thought was a very nice touch.
Continuous demonstration flying was in the lean years essential. The initial RAF order, placed in 1967, was not likely to sustain the company for long. As part of the sales drive, two Harriers were displayed at the 1968 Farnborough show. Amongst the thousands of spectators, including air attachés and service chiefs, were three United States Marines.
As chief designer, I was on duty in the Hawker Siddeley Chalet on the first Monday. To my astonishment, I was introduced there to three Marine Corps officers, Brigadier General Johnson, Colonel Miller, and Lieutenant Colonel Bud Baker. And when we'd gone through the pleasantries, we sat down preparatory to lunch, and they announced rather quietly that they'd come to UK to fly the Harrier. And please, could we help them by giving them a copy of the pilot's notes?
We had not had any experience of asking a foreign country to fly their airplanes before. And when we mentioned it, there was a number of questions as to how much flight experience we've had of all kinds of airplanes and whether we felt that we were capable of flying it. We felt that certainly there was not any problem for us flying it. It was just convincing the British that we were capable of flying it. We had hoped that we could, and fortunately on the Saturday, next to the last day of Farnborough, Mr. Bill Bedford came up to us and informed us that we had been approved to fly the airplanes, and we had originally thought if we could get two or three flights each would be really all we could ask for. Well, Mr. Bedford apologized to some extent that they could only give us 10 flights each, so we kind of swallowed and said thank you very much and accepted. I recall very vividly my first press up, and the airplane became a cork out of a champagne bottle. It was headed straight up very rapidly, and I had a lot of trouble getting the power off so that I didn't wind up on instruments in the hover, which would certainly have been a poor way to end up on your first flight, but got it stopped, and I found the hovering aspect of it very intoxicating, and in fact they finally had to tell me that I should come down because I enjoyed it so much. It was a very smooth handling, very unlike a helicopter in hover, and the airplane appeared very, very stable, and I soon became very confident of the handling qualities of it.
As the two Marine test pilots became familiar with the excellent flying qualities of the unusual aircraft, their confidence increased to the point where they decided experimentally to deflect the thrust by rotating the nozzles during simulated combat maneuvers. This radical technique had not up to that time been tried.
To our knowledge, it had not been done before, and apparently from the way they were rather shocked when we asked for it, that they hadn't explored it either. It started out very much as a typical air war would start, with one airplane on the tail of the other. Colonel Baker at my 6 o'clock are on my tail, and I'm in a hard turn, and then I use the nozzles into the nozzle position, And it was so startling because I said to Bud, I said, "You ready?" And he said, "Yes." I pulled the nozzle into the braking position, and he says, "Oops, where'd you go?" I literally disappeared in front of him.
12 years later, two Sea Harriers of 899 Squadron demonstrate the principle of vectoring the thrust in level flight. The nozzles are rotated downwards with instantaneous effect. To return to 1968, the enthusiastic reports which the two Marine test pilots took back with them to the United States resulted in an initial order for 12 AV-8A Harriers for the U.S. Marine Corps, the first aircraft being delivered in January 1971. Further orders brought the number up to 102 by 1974. AV-8As were embarked aboard USS Guam, and as a consequence of intensive combat and tactical evaluation, American Marine pilots have pushed the flight envelope of these Harriers to the limit, developing vectoring in flight, VIFing, to enable their Harriers to avoid being shot down by far faster fighters, convincing the US Marines that the aircraft is, for their unique purposes, close to ideal. Mindful of the very heavy losses in men that the Marine Corps sustained in capturing island airfields in the Pacific during World War II, it's the ability of the Harrier to operate from almost anywhere, close to their men on the ground, that has most impressed the Marines, enabling them to counter strong congressional opposition to buying foreign. The Spanish Navy bought 8 Harrier Matadors. But the question asked by other potential buyers was simply this: if the Harrier is so good, why doesn't the Royal Navy order it? The simple answer was that the Royal Navy didn't want them, at least not while they had the F-4K Phantoms and a secure carrier force. But the winds of change were blowing strongly. CVA-10, the supercarrier, never left the drawing board. As the carriers it was intended to replace, HMS Eagle and Ark Royal, swung at anchor awaiting scrapping, their aircraft, the Phantoms and Buccaneers, were presented to the RAF. To fly Navy, in the 80s, would be to fly helicopters. To replace the scrapped carriers, 3 new ships were ordered, to be called, in deference to the politicians, through-deck cruisers. The first, HMS Invincible, was launched at Barrow-in-Furness in May 1977. And although in all but name an aircraft carrier, was designed to operate only helicopters. The helicopters were to be Western Sikorsky Sea Kings, and intended to operate in a hunter-killer anti-submarine role, being equipped with a formidable electronic search capability. However, British aerospace test pilot John Farley demonstrated that anything a helicopter can do, a Harrier can do better. In addition to flying backwards, Harriers were demonstrated operating from the helicopter pads aboard small ships. In all, Harriers were flown from no fewer than 18 ships of various nations. By the mid-70s, the Royal Navy was officially admitted to be considering a possible Sea Harrier. A change of attitude possibly influenced by intelligence reports that the Russians were building aircraft carriers. This was confirmed beyond doubt when an RAF Nimrod photographed a Kiev-class carrier with possible V-Stol aircraft embarked. These aircraft were positively identified as Yakolov 36s, NATO codename Forger. Although Forger superficially looks like a Harrier, it's a very different aircraft, as John Fossard reveals.
And I've done an engineering drawing of the aircraft here from which we can understand the principles of how it works. Here you can see it has a single propulsive type engine at the back to which they apparently have added a pair of Pegasus rear nozzles, so the thrust of this engine can be directed rearwards or downwards or perhaps forward of the vertical. And because that is acting well behind the balance point of the aircraft here, which has to be there in the middle of the wing, they've clearly made use of a pair of lift engines, which you can see air goes in at the top and the jets exhaust through the bottom at the front of the aircraft. Now, it doesn't take really much more than fifth form physics to look at this aircraft and to see if that's the balance line of the aircraft where the weight is acting, then in vertical flight, the thrust of that engine must support half the weight of the aircraft, and the thrust of these two engines must also support half the weight of the aircraft. because from the geometry of the pictures, it's very easy to see that that distance is roughly equal to that one. The thing is very unsafe as an aircraft, depending on three engines, because it can't possibly sustain flight if one of the three fails.
In the light of this Russian development, it was fortunate that in 1975, Sea Harriers were at last ordered for the Royal Navy to operate from the new see-through cruisers, as the Navy now cynically called them. Sea Harriers differ from the RAF aircraft mainly in a raised cockpit and the use of corrosion-proof alloys. The initial training of the Fleet Air Arm pilots was undertaken by the RAF. Then the Sea Harrier squadrons worked up during 1979 at Yeovilton.
Joining from the hold as usual, 1,500 feet from the hold, staying to the west of the railway line and also avoiding Kidwelly.
Two Sea Harriers of 899 training squadron take off from Yeovilton in the summer of 1979 to revive the art of fixed-wing flying from a Fleet Air Arm carrier. Although the number of Sea Harriers to be embarked is far less than that of a conventional fixed-wing seaborne force, the lack of numbers is compensated for, it is claimed, by the quick reaction to an enemy threat. Harriers can self-start and take off without involving complex operations, without the ship even having to turn into the wind. They have a multi-role capability: fighter, reconnaissance, and strike. The carrier is the veteran HMS Hermes. In 1979, it was fitted only for helicopter operations, so the Sea Harriers adopt a helicopter approach, slowly drawing alongside the port quarter, then slipping over the flight deck to a vertical touchdown. Very different from the conventional arrested landing. As one ex-Phantom pilot put it, it's a lot easier to stop and land than to land and stop. This helicopter technique is now adopted as standard for Harriers. Hermes is a small carrier, yet unlike conventional jets, the Harrier could make a rolling takeoff. But there was the danger in a heavy sea of the ship pitching down at the moment of takeoff. The problem was elegantly solved by a Royal Navy officer, Lieutenant Commander Doug Taylor. Why not, he suggested, build a ski jump? John Farthy did most of the ski jump development flying.
And it's a beautiful way to take off. It is the easiest way of any sort of aircraft takeoff that I know. And you might think that's an exaggeration. You might think it's a sales pitch. It is not. For instance, we have taken people who've never flown the Harrier, never even taxied the Harrier, and we've put them in the front seat of that particular two-seater, and we stood them at the beginning of the ramp and said, take off. And they said, bah, 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 bah. You know, and we said, no, you take off. Now, well, you show me. Now, you do it. Or tell me what I've got to do. And when you tell them what little they have to do, they find they can do it. And what they have to do is to take the throttle and push it from fully back to fully forward. Not terribly difficult to do. Then they have got to keep the stick in their hand and move it to the left or right to keep their wings level after they leave the end of the ramp. And that is all they have to do to control the aircraft. And they can't believe it. They don't even have to move it backwards and forwards. They don't have to make it climb, because the ramp is a curved device that launches the aeroplane by itself climbing out of ground effect and going away from the ground. And that's what all pilots are trained to try and achieve as they leave the runway, or the ramp does it for them.
After experimenting at the Royal Aircraft Establishment, Bedford, to discover the optimum angle, it was decided to incorporate a 7-degree ramp on HMS Invincible. 7 degrees is less than desirable, but it was imposed by an existing structure on the ship's bow. Later ships of the class will probably have a 12-degree ramp. HMS Invincible is the world's largest gas turbine-powered ship, using the same engines as Concorde, four Rolls-Royce Olympus. And if she is not the largest ship ever commissioned into the Royal Navy, she is certainly the most expensive. Sea Harriers are being formed into three frontline seaborne squadrons. With the completion of their training, the fleet air arm will once more have a fixed wing capability embarked on aircraft carriers. The second carrier, HMS Ark Royal, is now being fitted out. HMS Invincible steams into a Force 8 gale off the Scillies in November 1980. The press are on board to witness the formal token embarkation of 800 Squadron, the first to complete its training.
Just hold it for a minute. And we're steady now. And very nice. We're going to be taxiing you hard right behind the island. And we have all three. British Flyco, all three Harriers on deck.
The event was the culmination of intensive work by 899 Training Squadron, whose CO, Lieutenant Commander Nigel Ward, an ex-Phantom pilot, sums up the Sea Harrier.
The aircraft is quite without equal. It is totally viceless and very forgiving. So we find ourselves teaching young men to do fighter combat and pressing them to beyond the limits of the aeroplane until the aeroplane gives up and says, no, I don't want to do that at that speed. And then it falls out of the sky. In other aircraft, that would be a danger sign. But with this aircraft, you can recover it very quickly indeed. And so they're very fortunate. They can learn the fighting game without any serious consideration for their own safety.
But it won't be until later this summer that HMS Invincible's hangar will house its first permanent Sea Harrier squadron, though the maintenance facilities and the skilled tradesmen are ready to keep the aircraft airworthy while at sea for extended periods. A Harrier costs around £3 million and must be one of the most intensively developed aircraft ever. It has, after all, due to political indecision, taken 19 years to get it into service. If the same timescale had been applied to the Spitfire, it would have been just 15 years late for the Battle of Britain. Vertical takeoff aircraft, a British development, have given rise to another, the ski jump, which is now to be adopted by the United States Navy. The ski jump does more than ensure that the Sea Harriers leave simply pointing the right way. Even a 7-degree jump means less fuel, and therefore an increased payload, and reduces the takeoff run, which means that Harriers can operate from smaller and therefore cheaper ships. Today, the long-term future of the Harrier lies, as it did in 1968, 3,000 miles away across the Atlantic Ocean with the United States Marines. At the Cherry Point Marine Base in North Carolina, pilots train on both conventional jets and the AV-8A. Here, an experienced U.S. Air Force pilot makes his first solo vertical takeoff and landing. At first, because of the unique nature of the Harrier, the United States Marines used only above-average pilots to fly them, with the result that it was considered easy and simple. As a consequence, helicopter pilots were converted. The result, an accident rate of a similar ratio to that of the RAF's. So the present Marine policy is to take only the top 20% of the flight schools for Harrier training, and to maintain a very high standard indeed among totally committed pilots.
Okay, not a bad sortie.
Not a great sortie.
Not bad.
This pilot is converted in every sense to the Harrier.
Yeah. I've been flying for a lot of years, and I thought I'd about seen everything, but boy, I sure haven't. This is amazing.
The official attitude of the U.S. Marine Corps is equally enthusiastic. The wing commander at Cherry Point, General Maloney.
We are convinced that it can do a special job, our special job for us, better than anything else. We would like to go to an all-light attack V-STOL force. You know, we're looking vigorously into a follow-on version of it, which has twice the capability. And downstream, later on in years to come, we would expect there's still other generations of vector thrust.
McDonnell Douglas, the United States licensee, have produced an uprated version of the Harrier, which they call the AV-8B. The prototype is in fact a conversion from an 8A and was produced in collaboration with British Aerospace and Rolls-Royce. Its promotion, though, is 100% American.
In the 1980s, the Marine Light Attack Force will become all V-STOL with the introduction of the McDonnell Douglas AV-8B. The AV-8B is an improved version of the Harrier. The YAV-8B prototype is an A model modified to demonstrate its enhanced performance and flying qualities. Technology advances of the AV-8B, which significantly improve performance, include a new supercritical wing made from lightweight, long-life composite material. Lift improvement devices that capture reflected jet exhaust add lift during takeoff and landing. The improved inlets increase engine thrust for vertical takeoff and enhance cruise performance.
Is the 8B to be the Harrier of the future? British Aerospace consider that for the RAF, the GR5 development is a more appropriate choice.
It's different in many ways from the AV-8B because the AV-8B was designed in the Marine Corps context, and the Mark V offers types of operational capability which I believe as designer we must not neglect or ignore in any British contribution to the NATO pact strength. Now, beyond that next-generation aircraft, which could enter RAF service in 1985 or 1986, whether it's an AV-8B or whether it's a Mark V Harrier, beyond that, there is increasingly, obviously, a need for a supersonic type of jump jet. You remember we were designing and indeed building the 1154 15 years ago, and one can now see a bit more clearly that grandson of 1154 could be coming back, and it's a candidate for use on land and even use on ships from sometime in the 1990s.
At the McDonnell factory in St. Louis, they're preparing for an initial order of 348 Bs, which would supplant these F-18s on the production lines. However, apart from the 8B prototype, which is a conversion, McDonnell Douglas have yet to build a single Harrier. They've simply assembled and serviced aircraft constructed in Britain. Britain's share of the US Marine order would be 30% of the airframes and 70% of the engines. The generation after the 8B will be supersonic VSTOL. What will British Aerospace's involvement in that development be?
We have discussed collaboration with our British friends on this, and we have told them to some extent what we're doing. But to this point, we haven't developed any agreed approach as to how to proceed. It's my feeling with respect to collaboration on a supersonic aircraft that this would be a natural follow-on to collaboration on the AV-8B for UK requirements. Conversely, I see a bit of a problem if the RAF and the British government decides to build their own airplane, would tend to put us in a competition which would distract from attempting to collaborate on a supersonic airplane.
The decision to replace RAF Harriers with the AV-8B is imminent. Although the aircraft does not meet all the requirements, it comes pretty close, and the risk attached to the GR5 and the possibility of losing AV-8B work seems to have taken the edge off the extra performance available. Now that the American government supports the AV-8B, a share in the 340 Marine Corps aircraft probably outweighs the advantages of a 100 aircraft British program. The crucial question now is what happens next. Does British Aerospace fade out of the VSTOL field, or will the government back the AV-8B decision with money for a supersonic Harrier development? The potential market for this aircraft is enormous, particularly in America, where the US Navy might join the program. The market will not appear for 10 to 15 years, but the work needs to start now, preferably as a joint and equal venture with the British and the Americans.
For the moment, British Aerospace's best export prospect is the Sea Harrier. India, Australia, Spain and Italy are all serious potential buyers. The Chinese, too, are contemplating Harriers, and for political reasons would probably buy British. With the 8B ordered for the RAF, realistically, British Aerospace appears to have no alternative but to cooperate as partners with McDonnell Douglas. Though it remains a cruel irony that after 20 years of development in Britain, the Harriers of the future will become commercially successful bearing the imprint Made in USA.